tower, at the base of it, behind the veranda, was the woman's lounge and study area. And that's where book club met. It was the only one of the club rooms on the ground floor that had its own private restroom, and a piano, and a fireplace. And of course, the hotel itself, as well as a lot of the aspirations for the community, were all tied up in a remote location up in the Cascade Mountains. It sounds like Monte Cristo expected to make everybody very, very rich. Christine Vest really has a literary association because we all know about the Count of Monte Cristo. We all know about Dumas' novel. Well, back in 1889, 1890, 1891, everybody, I don't know, knew about it. They were reading it. They had copies in their satchels. And Everett's destiny, to some extent, became involved with a town site up in the Cascades that never really paid off. Turns out, a gentleman by the name of Dickman, who was the mining engineer that came up with a prognosis for that particular location up there, was maybe a little optimistic, but our fissured and fragmented and seismically shaken area, you can't trace the vein of gold the way you can in the Rockies, for instance. As a result of that, there's gold and silver and copper and lead in there, arsenic as well, as we know well. We have a couple pieces of their original stationery. As it turned out, one of the reasons the hotel was such a favorite spot for the book club was that Joe Irving, who was the husband of one of the members of the club, was the manager at that time. So nice, comfy accommodations. Again, inside that octagonal tower down there at the base, you've got the front windows, the sunset, some spectacular sunsets. Sadly, it had been torn down. Became eventually Providence Hospital. The Sisters of Providence acquired it from the Rucker brothers, who acquired it from the Rockefeller Group as part of the settlement of their holdings after the collapse of the venture back in the middle of the Silver Dan. And quite a little park and recreation area down in the gully inside of this as well. A little lake, a small menagerie, canoes. The book club didn't waste a whole lot of time going directly to city government. Here's the old city hall down on Broadway. It was on the east side of Broadway, just about half a block south of Hewitt. It was torn down after the 1930 city hall was constructed. They were told every time they arrived, we'd love to help you, but we don't have any resources to invest. And every time they bring along something, as I said, they loved the quote from poetry that alluded to, Oliver Wendell Holmes may use the phrase about the Boston Public Library, "This palace is the people's own." Frequently they talked about the palace that would be the people's own when they wanted to construct. Didn't go too well with the city council, didn't have any money to spend on basic services. And they talked about, they used those phrases. They talked about a public library, the same as Holmes did, as being the queen and the handmaid to a community. The library provided the most basic information about the most fundamental aspects of daily life, and at the same time as Shakespeare and Dickens inside, and the view. And that's what they wanted for their community, something that provided all those services. And perhaps just to give themselves a breather, the city council said, well, how about this? We'll give you free rooms upstairs between the police department and the other offices up on the upper floor. They were happy with that. They went ahead and actually sent Alice McFarland, the daughter of one of the club members, down to Seattle to shadow the director of Seattle Public Library and find out exactly what the mysterious things that library directors do were all about. And she could come back up and at a bargain rate paid by the members of the book club be the pro tem head librarian of the new library that they were going to build entirely, as it turned out, with gifts from other Federated Women's Clubs across the country. So I've never been able to find an indication that get entire sets of books from all over the place, from the East Coast, from the deep South, even out of the country. There are books that arrive. I saw the accessions book, which shows all the books that came in. Right there listed with books that are from the private collection of Everett Colby, our collections of Robert Louis Stevenson, and Sir Walter Scott. And all of them, somewhat to the dismay of the McFarland family, were in the parlor of the McFarland cottage, which made it almost impossible to use that room. And Alice eventually put them into some kind of order. Everyone was impressed. They accepted the offer from the city and discovered almost immediately that you don't want to try to run a library immediately upstairs from a fire department or immediately adjoining a police department. The police department booking the desk was about 30 feet north of where people lined up to check out books. So from here, people need to check in the city jail. And every time a fire breaks out anywhere, all hell breaks loose on the fourth floor. Because they're all horse, everything is horse drawn. So the bells would be the signal that the horses would need to come around and get ready to get harnessed up. So there wasn't a such thing as a quiet fire call. It was awesome. It shook the whole entire building. They may not win, but they did bear it. In spring, April 1898, is when the first library opened in the building you see there. And they held on until the early years of the 20th century under those circumstances. So providing virtually everything except the actual roof over their heads, which tended to tremble at the sound of the bell. That's Mrs. McFarland with a lorgnette in the dark, second from the left. This is Mrs. Dreyeuf with McFarland. And this from that same 1895 photograph that we've been before. Alice McFarland, they lived on Colby, the little house that, as I said, was the repository up until the time they got the space in the city hall. They carried them, the description of newspapers, but people, they carried, a lot of them carried the books in their arms. And lovingly took them space between Colby Avenue and down Broadway. It must have been a great home. Well, in the meantime, out of the wreckage of misspent fortunes, I believe that's how the question is, Jim Hill stepped in and purchased what was left of Rockefeller's holdings and almost immediately rekindled the huge land rush that happened back in the 1890s. What he saw was Everett, in spite of the bad times, had gone from 5,000 population in 1893 when it was first chartered. And so, to 8,000 in 1900, between 1900 and 1910, it jumped from 8,000 people to 24,000 people. Long before that happened, the Women's Book Club was looking for other ways to try and respond to Everett's sudden growth spurt. And of course, Everett had become almost overnight so popular that it was attracting attention from places that no one would dreamed of. Teddy Roosevelt came through here when he was running for office after he became president and vice president after Kennedy's assassination. And here you see his great amusement described by an Everett citizen who was just a little guy at the time when Roosevelt headed up in a horse-drawn parade up Hewitt Avenue from down the river. The ladies of the evening who were with some of the dives along the north side of Hewitt Avenue stood on top of their little houses and waved at them. And little Max Miller, whose parents were strict Methodists and did not even approve of him being down in that neighborhood under any circumstances, although the ladies in the houses were very generous and they picked up empty bottles and even doubled the actual cost of the newspaper, little Max watched with fascination as the President of the United States waved to the painted ladies of Everett's Riverside neighborhood. You know what? Adam Hill insisted that even the ladies and the dowels of the Riverside were largely readers. And they would borrow books from a little lending library that he had and buy periodicals all the time. He insisted that actually Everett's prostitutes were amazingly literate. Of course, years later, little Max grew up to be a famous writer who who talked about how he was recruited by a local editor of the Everett Morning Tribune. Asim Kenwick was encouraging him to write stories about what was going on in the town for the newspaper. And among the stories in the town that Max eventually wrote, the stories of Teddy Roosevelt being treated by the ladies of the evening. He said Max moved down to La Jolla and was a successful writer for many, many years. Known primarily, I guess, for his famous I Cover the Waterfront, which was a big hit back there in the 1930s. Everett High Grad, Max State Trading. During the century, the book club was just as determined as it ever was to assure that there was going to be a permanent, well-staffed, well-operated library. They discovered that the Carnegie Foundation was the place they needed to work with. Alice Baird, whose husband, Selman Baird, and one of the heads of the Everett Monte Cristo Railway, that now is in the hands of the Rockwell brothers, was one of the main forces in getting letters drafted to the Carnegie Foundation talking about the need here for a real, honest to goodness library that didn't have a fire alarm attached to the floor. And in the meantime, they did all kinds of interesting stuff to raise money. This is the spring of 1902, and refined sketches and farce comedy at the Everett Theater. A whirlwind of songs and laughter, beautiful ladies, pretty girls, up-to-date jokes, fine dancing, new songs, the merriest hit this season. Admission 75 to 25 cents. And all of it going to support a public library. 80 gadgets. And they went back to Mr. Ivy, who designed the county courthouse back in the late 90s, and asked him, they already knew that the Carnegie Foundation liked Kim Meaden White's design for the Boston Public, who didn't, right? So they said, why don't you try to make just a kind of a little jewel box version of Boston Public? And Heidi, who was conversant with virtually every style imaginable, came back with a wonderful design for a building that is if he just sort of took the elements of the Kim Meaden White design in Boston and shrank them down to a fraction the size of a tiny little jewel box version of Boston Public. This is the way it looked before they filled in the front there on the side of the tree. It was built where the Chamber of Commerce had attempted to build something that looked a lot like an Italian fortress and ran out of money in 1893. So a derelict, empty Italian fortress stood on this spot until it began to collapse in the early years of the 20th century. And Henry Hewitt and others arranged to get it transferred to the library so that everyone could finally have this honest and honest library. You can't read the sign over the door into the basement, but because this was originally Chamber of Commerce land, the Chamber of Commerce used the basement of the building as its office space on the bay side of Everett, up until the time that a new Monte Cristo Hotel was built in 1925, using, incidentally, 500 bricks from the old Monte Cristo Hotel where the book club used to meet. And then it moved its offices into the Monte Cristo Hotel. Wonderful little building recently. Worked on, sadly, tragically, not the county museum that we hope to see placed in there, but on the National Register of Historic Places, and recently renovated and hopefully an important part of Sebouche County's plans for the foreseeable future. We still have a sign. The county got tired of having people wander in and ask to check out books, so we've got the public library sign displayed here. And of course, this has always been a working class town with, in some cases, some rather rigid class strata. But the fact is that Everett always has had writers, photographers, like Jay and Julene's, Vivian's, that were working for the studio back in the 1930s and 40s. Matter of fact, I think it's maybe actually done by Everett Murray under the Julene studio imprint. That's supposedly a moonlit view of the Snohomish River. In fact, the composite of four different negatives taken from out of the river at various times. lean photograph. It shows people at work. Imagine our darker side came to a cruel sort of peak in 100 years ago this year with the Everett massacre, where free speech demonstrators insisting they had a right to express their discontent with the capitalist system found themselves beaten and driven out of town, and eventually armed men shoot up at the city dock, resulted in at least a dozen dead people, and still the bloodiest labor confrontation in the Pacific Northwest history. So that particular fight has it's still with us in ways that are not entirely dealt with. We'll see. It'll be very interesting to see later this year how people respond to the centenary of the Everett shootout. Another wonderful industrial photograph characterizing Everett in the 1930s as an industrial fortress like the one that everyone was hoping for back in the 1890s when the Great Northern was pushed this way here over the Cascades and down to the Pacific Rim. When times got rough for the library, they used the same kind of donation that the Women's Book Club had talked about from the very beginning. If you can't afford to rent a brick and mortar branch, you buy yourself a fruit and vegetable vending truck, and you put the books in there. Mabel Ashley, a genius of a lady who was the library director here for many, many years, was responsible. As a matter of fact, that's her at the wheel. Nobody except Mabel drove it at first. They had to stiffen up the suspension so much that if you didn't slow way down before you grabbed a big turn, you would frequently come up on two wheels. But we have Pegasus again. Pegasus, she was named Pegasus, some of you may be familiar with a book that has a horse named Pegasus, pulling a book truck, Parnassus on wheels, inspired the librarians to describe this vehicle as Pegasus, or Peggy, as she's familiar with people. And Everett, well, in the 1930s, international prizes in Paris photographic competition, for instance, were won with images of warehouses and modern facilities being erected at Everett. Everett, maybe even to some extent inspired by groups that have from time to time sprung up to address specific problems, whether it was the Committee of 21 back in 1892 or the Women's Book Club in 1894, that Everett has had a tendency to say, the hell we can, at times when things look really, really impossible. And the images that came out during the 1930s in the peak of another major depression, inspirational, historic industrial progress. And finally, one of those industrialists gave the city an enormous gift. A couple of brothers from Lancashire who had worked as secretaries briefly for Henry Hewitt. They came from the same part of England that he did. And Leonard Howard, you see here, was confined to a wheelchair most of the last part of his life. When he died, he left a large gift of money to the city of Everett to spend as it chose. And in the early years of the Great Depression, miraculously, the committee that was looking at how to spend that money decided that Everett had outgrown its Carnegie Library and was going to spend that money to build a brand new library, the one that we're in right at the moment. He chose Carl Gould. Oh, controversial. Very controversial. By this time, of course, he'd been at war with Roland Hartwig, and Hartwig's from the governor. And so he and his partner, Charles Herbert Bebb, Carl Gould and Charles Herbert Bebb were very much on the outs with much of the political power structure. But he'd done such a spectacular job on the University of Washington campus, the Sisolo Library, that Mabel Ashley and the others embraced in his participation in the construction of a modern industrial port public library. If UW's Sisolo is industrial Gothic elegance for the sake of academia, the Everett Public Library was a wonderful example of Dutch secessionist influence turned its way into a striking, very modern building from 1933-34. Design work was actually done in the spring of 33, and that was completed in October of 1934. And we're chock full of all wonderful, wonderful things in here. This building has not only architectural touches that are showing off the skills of Carl Boo and C.H. Bev. But builder's photographs, we have some of James Green's original nitrate negative showing the construction of the building in 1933-34. NRA tags in on the door. Beautiful aluminum work. And of course, not too long ago, what am I saying, 25 years ago, we restored a lot of the damage that had been done back in the 1960s to Gould's original touches. Things like the wonderful repoussé sculptures of the doorways for the history of books. We're in the process of planning and restoring the last of the damaged murals of the club done by John T. Jacobson. Ted Jacobson first went on to become a very prominent architect and designing the house with Frank Lloyd Wright, a number of landmark buildings in the Hawaiian Islands. But back in 1934, and after just a couple months, he did these wonderful dreams of Everett. Giving the idea of Everett looking at visions of itself and the future in context, no longer romanticizing hand blogging or looking backward into the colorful past as imagined by people who long for Paul Bunyan. They went with images of visions of the past and visions of the future. And of course, touches that even to this very day. I think when I was probably about 5 or 6 when I first noticed the St. George and the Dragon, fire. All these things came out of Gould's office. People who were craftsmen there worked specifically on projects that they felt strongly about. There it is. I was just standing along the patio of Florentine Apartments, looking really grim over there on the left. And then, of course, in addition, and I boxed up that over there in the zinc of 1963. And I put a framework across the front that I thought a lot of people thought was just a temporary thing that lasted until 1990. The old information department that was in the Atlantic, so south end of it, long gone, completely erased. It was erased in the 1990 edition. The includes some touches that I think are a little kinder, a little softer than the fiberglass and aluminum was used back in 1962 and 63. And of course, through the vision of our luck at finding inspired leadership and hooking up the right craftsmen, in this case, Rich Byers, beautiful apotheosis of the Everett Women's Book Club. You're in this, you know the sculpture there, that you're in it. You're in the skies. You're the angels dropping books. Have you seen that? Rich Byers, who did Waiting for the Interim, and depicted Everett as being a place where angels provided books for the ministries. That's the Evergreen Ranch. The Evergreen Ranch. We were lucky to get Rich. That was one of his, that's actually Rich when he started doing sculptures. Everett was one of the places he was most interested in. Found out about this powerful statement about what was accomplished by a woman who said, help me. And of course, likewise, with the 1990 expansion and renovation. What can we say? I'm just going to be able to do the survey. Architectural critics love it. We've got AI awards. We got awards from the state for the restoration of the old part. And I had to laugh, but one architectural critic was certain that he saw it here, direct traces of the early Renaissance. we're looking at here is clearly, see the bowed steps going out and the handrails? That's Michelangelo's Laurentian library entrance, right? Rich Cardwell really choked. He said, I've never actually seen that. He said, when he was in Florence, they'd been out partying the night before, he'd actually seen the Laurentian library. So what he's doing is, he's not taking the steps coming into the building. It's a quote from Carl, it's not a quote from Michelangelo, it's a quote from Carl Boole. On the outside, I think Mabel actually would feel completely loved. The entrance is stored back to the way it was. Another example of what happens when a group like, there's no other group like the Women's Book Club. I can't compare your book club to another group because it is unique. Components are unique. The history of it is unique. And what we receive from you is inestimable. Like I said, down in the corner of St. Paul's, you know, if somebody's looking for your monument, look around. Everywhere you see the good work. Public Library, claim credit for it. Deserve it. Thank you. Do you have any other comments for the public officials?
The old Monte
Cristo,
is it located where the current one is?
No, the original was up at Pacific and Cromer. It's now part of Providence Hospital. They were rebuilding. They were building a new Monte Cristo Hotel exactly the time they were tearing down the old one that was built in the hospital. Hey, thank you for inviting me.